We're here with Kris Schermerhorn from Northern Virginia Dental Lab. Kris, it's 2020. You have been one of the key opinion leaders and really industry experts on thermoplastics. Can you give us your opinion, or really where you think the market is going from a removable partial standpoint of some of these latest and greatest innovations out of companies?
Yeah, so, you know, I think removables kind of making a comeback in our industry. In other words, you know, so my father started the lab before me. I came in and came into this kind of with knowledge from him. And, you know, through our history, the removal side of our industry was always the dirty side and the more labor intensive side. And now, you know, with the digital designing, milling, it's now becoming something that's less dirty and a little bit more of a profit maker. And I think that's really important, because now with being so competitive on the crown and bridge side of our industry, you know, removable techs just can't be found. And I think really our removable side is going to be the up and coming side of our industry. And all these materials, design, mill, even the 3D printing stuff that's coming along, is all helping to do that.
You know, and Kris, you mentioned it. It's kind of like the dirty side of the business, removables and dentures. You're a second generation lab owner. How did the decision, or when did it make sense to you to take that business from analog to digital?
Yeah, so, you know, I'm a 6-person lab, so not really a large lab. And I spend a lot of my days on the crown and bridge side, and a lot of my day on the removable side. I'm kind of really split. You kind of have to in your lab that size. And so we jumped in on the crown and bridge side probably, you know, future. And really, it's like a lot of labs, and really what I'd recommend. We started out outsourcing everything, you know, design, mill, everything. We just kind of stained and glazed them when they came back. Then we, our outsourcing costs became such that it made sense to get a scanner and some design software. Once the cost of still getting that stuff milled and also having control and be able to get things done quickly if we needed to, we then decided to purchase a mill and a sintering furnace and the other parts that come with that. And so really I just based it on what my outsourcing costs were. And once it made sense that a monthly lease would kind of cover that, I made that transition. And it's been a really good transition.
And for thermoplastics specifically, when does it make sense, or is it more additive versus subtractive, or do you think it's more of a business case of, you know, who wants to mill versus print it?
Yeah. So, you know, the materials right now are much stronger and more accurate milling. And the cool thing is, you know, you guys had Greg on from Sierra Tools. Now with these tooling that's becoming larger and faster, now the mills are starting to compete with the 3D printing as far as speeds are concerned. Don't get me wrong, just like Greg, I think that the 3D printing is definitely going to be a huge part of this, but I kind of see a combo. I kind of see a base in material and a thermoplastic that can have the strength, the thin, dainty design, and then maybe the saddle areas where we have the pink saddle areas as well as the teeth, that part might be printed. So we actually might be a bit of a combo of the mill side coming together with the 3D printed side to make the perfect appliance, totally digital.
So Kris, there are a lot of different millable materials out there specifically for partials. In your opinion, where and when does a product that's clear like VisiClear or some of the other options like Zerlex Acetyl, where and how do you distinguish when to use them and where really what's right for the patient?
That's a really loaded question. I mean, that's a deep one right there. So to break it down to the materials that I know, you know, so you have PMMAs. PMMAs, you know, aren't necessarily super strong. You know, they're strong enough for certain indications. They're not super strong, right? So when we do acrylic partial, whether it's milled or we do it in our lab, just packing it or whatever, you know, they're 2, 2.5, maybe even 3 millimeters thick, because they have to be to have enough strength to last in the mouth. When it comes to a VisiClear, Duraflex or Duracetyl or Zerlex Acetyl, you're looking at, you know, 1.2, maybe 1.4 in certain instances of a major connector thickness. And so much more smaller, much more dainty, because those materials are 8 to 10 times stronger than PMMAs. So on the low end of the scale, you're going to have PMMA, right? That can be used for bike splints, acrylic type partials, temporary situations where thickness, it's going to be in there for a time, but patient can deal with it during that time. Then you're going to jump to things like materials like the Visiclear Duraflex and the Zurelex Acetyl, where now becomes a choice of what you want in those materials. And so the Duraflex and the Visiclear are the same thing. It's just the Visiclear is a clear version of the Duraflex. All right.
Right.
So everything I talk about between the two, keep in mind that, you know, they go for each. So those are more flexible. They have a great deal of flex, probably the most aesthetic option because of the clarity of them and the translucency. So with those, if rigidity, stability isn't as much of an issue, they're a really good choice. Jump over to the Zurelex Acetyl. It's still flexible, still comfortable, but has a little bit more rigidity to it. So in an instance where you have a longer span or the doctor wants a rest, something like that, well, then the acetyl resin becomes a nice option. We have several videos online that kind of lay out those materials. And I think really the lab tech will be the one to make that choice along with the doctor for that individual patient.
Kris, what about a lab that is still processing their partials or their removable department is still analog? You know, it makes sense for a crown and bridge to a lab to maybe start the transition because they're already somewhat digital. You know, the design software is there and ready. But some of these other labs in the industry that are only removables and really focused on the analog process, do you have any advice or suggestions on how maybe they take that first step into the digital workflow?
Yeah, it's very simply partner yourself with a good company, right? So Henry Schein's a good example of that. They have great support for the softwares that they offer as far as design's concerned. Really, for those lab guys, they're going to be really scared to purchase all this and jump into a digital side of our industry. But believe it or not, digitally designing these when you have dental experience actually becomes pretty easy. You can be a little slow at it at first, but you're going to be able to work your way through it because it all makes sense to you. And so the part that's going to be scary is importing files or moving them from here to there. That's the part that's going to be a little above their head. And so if you partner yourself with a really good support company, that is really, you know, the whenever I was doing research, I kept going to people and asking them, hey, what mill is the best? What software is the best? And everyone kept saying, you know, all these softwares, all these mills are kind of neck and neck. They all have their advantages and disadvantages to each other, but they're all really good. He said, really, what the important thing is the company that supports you on that. And so that's a really important part.
The industry continues to evolve. We saw it go digital 7 or maybe even 10 years ago with zirconia. And it almost seems like we're getting to another revolution with digital dentures, you know, whether it's milling in-house or printing. Where do you see the market going around digital dentures? And as a lab owner and specifically a removable technician, you know, where do you see the future with digital dentures?
Yeah, I mean, I see it a lot like the zirconia and what happened with that, in that we did PFMs. They were super labor intensive. And then we shifted over to full zirconia. Full zirconias were ugly, you know, at the very start. They didn't have much translucency. They really weren't formulated to be a solid zirconia crown. But doctors are like, hey, these aren't that expensive. They're bulletproof. They're never going to break. And they fit like a glove. I'll kind of suffer. I'll put these in the very back and deal with that. Well, then as technology got better and the formulations of these zirconia started getting more translucency, still keeping a great amount of strength, we said, okay, well, now these are a little bit better. I'll move them up into some, you know, first molars or premolars. And then next thing you know, we got translucent zirconias that look as good as some of, you know, the lithium silicates and all these, you know, different materials out there. And now it's, you know, used in the anterior. And I think that's going to be the same sort of thing with removable. As the technology gets better, I think it's going to be adopted like it is now, maybe before it's even quite ready, especially when it comes to the 3D printing. You know, the fits and the materials that are available, you know, aren't as good as what we're able to fabricate, you know, the analog way, the old way. But they're close and they're getting closer and they're getting better looking. And so people are accepting them. They're kind of going through the trials and tribulations of moving them into our industry. And I think the technology, the materials, the machinery is going to catch up with that. And so, you know, definitely 2 to 3 years, I think it's going to be pretty close to the mainstream. And, you know, I've been on many meetings, many development companies. I've sat in on meetings as they're developing things. And, you know, I was like, well, this stuff isn't as strong and it isn't as good looking as what we can produce now. And really digitally designing a denture, you know, if you have a fast setup guy, I can set up a denture just as fast as I could design one digitally. I'm like, why are we doing this? They say, because I am a dying breed. We can't find the technicians to do this. And you can set up a denture that fast, but you've been doing it for 20 years. All right. You know, to get somebody that to set up that fast within just a few months when they have almost no dental experience, that's why we're going that direction, is because we're just running out of people that can do it.
It almost seems like it's an exactly like the zirconia revolution. It was, you know, at first, sure, hire a gamer off the street that can do the CAD CAM design. And it was really, okay, you know what? Maybe that's not the best method. They need to have some dental experience. They need to know occlusion. You know, it really sounds and seems like the denture market is really the same way. Sure, if you have someone with 20 plus years of experience, maybe they can do it faster. But for streamlining, for accuracy, it's almost one of those, hey, why wouldn't it make sense?
Yeah, I mean, you're going to have those guys, you know, observing the rest, right? So there's guys with experience. They're going to have certain points in the design process where they're going to call that experienced guy over and say, here's what we got. He's going to say, okay, move that here, move that there. You see, if you move that, he's going to be knocking these teeth off if you don't watch those excursions. And so I think that's really where it'll come. And that's going to be, again, cleaner. It's going to be less stressful. You know, it's going to be just a nicer way of doing things, I believe.
What, you know, from your own experience from an analog lab that's, you know, taken the steps to go digital years ago, what advice or recommendations do you have or can you offer for maybe some of those lab owners or technicians that might be a little hesitant to maybe embrace the change or the digital technology?
So I think very simply, kind of how I did it is find yourself a good outsourcing lab. And if a doctor sends you a digital denture, package the thing up and run it over to that lab or ship it to that lab and have them do it. And then as you get more and more of those dentures, you know, maybe get yourself some design software, right? And then you'll start to design yourself, but then you'll send those files over to whoever and have it milled or printed or however you go about it. And once you get enough accounts and enough demand, and it makes sense, then go ahead and purchase your 3D printer or your mill. And really, I mean, there's no reason, you're not going to make as much profit while you're doing the outsourcing, but you can establish, you know, when you start an $800 or a $1,500 or a $2,000 a month lease, you'll have the work already sitting there to support it. And so you don't have to jump in. And you'll learn everything as it goes. I mean, that lab's going to want you to send files over once you design, or if a doctor sends you a file and you want to pass it, you're going to start to learn the nuances of dealing with a computer and how to move stuff around. And it's just, I think that's a more comfortable way of going about it. And then if you have, you know, already that crown and bridge side where you've already been digital, it almost becomes a no-brainer on your removable side to really start moving that direction really quickly.
Well, Kris, we really appreciate your time on this issue of Tech Talk and look forward to seeing what comes out of your lab next.
Awesome. Well, I appreciate the time.
All right. Thanks a lot.